Okay, guys. My session today is for data integration and business processes. So what I'm going to talk about is basically what are the data integration scenarios we can do with our platform. So basically, I'll start with what is data integration and how can business process workflows help to do that. So this is the agenda. So I'll start with what are data integration techniques and tell a bit more about business process management. Then how these data integration and business process workflows work together, and I'll give a short overview of the WSO BPS and the DSS products, and I'll end up with a reference architecture on how we can do data integration with our platform. So, starting off, what do you mean by data integration? So, mainly what it means is when you have like in your environment like multiple disparate different data sources and so on, you want to get a single a consistent view of all of those information. So to do that, you would mainly have to do some other actions also. Like I have listed some here, like data cleansing, transformations, and like master data management when you are working with master data, and also like profiling. So you may want to like monitor what the data you have, what are the changes you are doing, and like check on the quality of the data. So you will do all these actions, and you will try to expose this as in a single interface to the outside users, the application, and so on. So that's what we mainly try to do with data integration. So I'll go into like a bit detail on those different aspects. So like data cleansing. So data cleansing is what we mainly do is we like load a specific set of a specific data set in, and we'll have a specific set of rules saying this data set should be in this format, or some fields has to have this specific format, and this data should be filled, and so on. Like, for example, a date format should be in a standard way. Like, it should be normalized and so on. So it should be in a consistent manner. So likewise, in this data cleansing stage, you will like go through the data set, check on all the rules, and if you can automatically decide on remedies on what to do on the data, you can automatically do it. You can automate the thing, and the software will do it for you. So, but there will be situations where there are like situations where the system cannot make a decision, where the a user or a human has to do intervene and make some decisions. So, in that situation, they will like put those scenarios in another different list where some user interaction is needed. So those kind of things, so the user has to come and make the decision, like set some parameters and so on, and again continue the flow. So at the end, you will do the transformations and so on and load it to a target system. So that's basically the rough thing we do with data cleansing. Also an important thing is data transformation. So that is also when we have like different types of data sets and so on, you may want to at the end have it in a specific data format. So maybe in the same, let's say employee information or something is there in different databases. Maybe you got it from a different acquisition of a company or something. And those are in different field names, different structures and so on. So you probably want to transform this data and get it to a single format. So that kind of things also you would want to do. So you load in the raw data, figure out the source schema, so what's the format that will be there in the source systems, and the target schema you will have, that you should have, and make the mapping out of it. So it can be either be an XSLT for XML data and so on. So you will have the mapping, and it's a matter of applying the transformation mapping and getting the output data. So and storing it a target system. So that's the typical transformation scenario. So moving on, another popular concept also is master data management. So in master data management, so we work with this specific type of data called basically master data. So master data is like mostly like constant data. So it's like opposite to transactional data, where in transactional data, you mostly refer to the master data. For example, I'll get an example. Let's say you have an employee master and some items in your inventory or something like that. You can say in a transaction, this let's say customers, this customer buys this item, and so on. So it's like in the transaction, you just say what these two, the relationship between these two items, and you basically refer to the master data. So that's normally what like what master data is, what it composes of. So so this master data is very valuable to the organization. So they always like to keep it in the best shape, like in a consistent manner. So managing this is very important. So like my early example, let's say the customer information you have, like that may actually be in multiple databases because of acquisitions and so on. But for like other end applications, you want to access all of this data in a consistent manner. Like you can't have, when you update a single system, it can't be like update only that. It should be synchronized with other data set and so on. So because of all these aspects should be handled, like I have shown here in this diagram, like you have three data sets, and it at the end it gets merged into a single master data repository. So one is that. So this creating of the single master data repository will need some logic, like how to merge it and so on. And also the other challenges, so we will already have like legacy applications that were already using the source systems. If they go and change it, we have to update the other systems as well, and so on. So those kind of things we have to manage properly by tracking where the data is going and so on. So that's master data management is also a very important aspect of like data integration. Moving on, so the for all of this at the end, what's again an important aspect is profiling. So what you do at the end, what the things you do for the data, you will have to like have a audit saying, okay, you did these changes and so on. And at the end, how is the data look like? Like, did I do a good job in cleaning the data? How did it transform and so on? So for this, you can basically do like profiling. So you will look at the containing data and go through that and see whether all the fields are fields, if they are all in the correct way and so on. You can get like statistics on the data, and you can like do further analysis and get an overall idea of how of the data quality, basically of the data sets you have. So for that, we mainly do data profiling. So let's move into the business processes aspect. I'll tell the relationship of this and the data integration later. So I'll first start with saying, okay, what is a business process? So it's basically a collection of related tasks to achieve a business goal, as it says. So it's a sequence of well-defined repeatable actions that you can do again and again. So you basically can define it as a business process. So there are some examples listed here for a business process. Like you will probably heard like popular examples like loan process, like insurance claim process, and so on. So they have a well-defined set of actions that you have to follow in order to from having a start to the end. So you can see here the materials procurement process. It has like starting place, and you can have like parallel activities going in, coming together, and so on. So you can have like a complex flow of events happening in your business process workflow, basically. So that's the idea of a business process. So generating the workflows like this. And then the idea is, so how to manage this all this business process, so business process management. So we have like a life cycle for this. So we start by the process design. So process design is where you define high level, okay, what is this process going to do, the workflow, what are the items. You will just give a high level overview of, okay, these are the actions and so on. And then you go into the process analysis. So there you can do like static analysis on the business processes and figure out, okay, if these parameters are set, if these like, for example, if these users are doing these actions in the in a specific path, how long will the whole process take time, and so on. So you can do like analysis like that and figure out like optimization and so on for the process definitions. And after that, it's the actual process implementation. So this is where we actually give the small implementation details, like, okay, what are the actions happening, the small details to actually execute it. And the next step it would be monitoring the executing process. So there we will be like monitoring, okay, what are things happening, what are the execution times, and so on. And so we have these values at hand after you do the process monitoring also. So after that, you will do the process optimization. So when you have the stats at hand and the process design and everything, you can optimize it, change some parameters, change how it's designed, and so on. You can again move into the process design, and you can do it in an iterative way to keep on improving the process definitions and so on. So that's the typical flow. So how this maps to like the solutions we have is like in our solution. So we have something called, actually we are going to get something called the process center. So this is where we will define the processes, like the definitions, how you initially model the thing. So in the process center, we will model it, put it there, and also we'll do the process analysis also, like the static analysis I mentioned earlier, through the process center, and he will say like, okay, what are the optimal parameters you should have, and so on, so on. And the process runtime, the process implementation part, we'll do with the business process server BPS and business rules server. So these where we'll, like, for example, a BPMN model, we'll get it and deploy there to actually run the thing. So, and the process monitoring will be done with our analytics platform, data analytics server, CEP, and so on. And also, we'll get the same information for process optimization using, again, our analytics server, CEP, DAS, machine learning, and so on. So you can do use all of these tools to finally do the optimization and do the to have ideal process design at the end. So those are the items. So now how does this business process workflows and data integration like come together? So data integration, as I said, requires like a repeatable sequence of actions, like well-defined actions, okay, what to do, like there may be complex logic there and so on. So this is ideal, this can be ideally used with business process workflows to define this logic. So it like naturally has a process where we can define the actions, like long-running processes and so on. So this is like the ideal solution to define scenarios like that. And basically, we can combine that with the the CRUD data services solutions we have with the data service server. So with the data workflows, we can call the external services and so on and get the pure data operations we need to do. So data service are like very optimized for these data operations, so we can delegate those stuff outside. So this is a rough like a feature list of business process server. So that's basically a summary. So WSO2BPS support full WS Beeple 2.0 support, and of course it supports long running stateful processes. So unlike our typical web services where they are mostly stateless, so Beeple and so these business processes are meant to be mostly used for long running stateful process. And also we do support short running stateless and stateful process also. And for this short running process, especially, we support an in-memory mode as well, so it basically runs quickly. And so the engine is basically powered by Apache Ord project. And also we support the WS human task spec as well. So for human interactions, like the early example I got with the data cleansing scenario, so like if in the middle of the process instance, if you need some user input, you can use this human task to do that. And also, we are going to have full BPMN 2.0 support with basically WSO2BPS version 3.5 onwards. We already have an alpha released, so in the upcoming months, the GA will be released soon. So after that, so I'll talk a bit about some of the features of the data service server as well. So basically, this is a solution for basically data virtualization. Like it's meant to hide the complexity of the backend databases and so on, and like give you a clean interface on accessing the different kinds of data sources. And so I'll go into different aspects. Like it supports full SOAP, RESTful interfaces. It have a high performance streaming, batching, and transaction execution support. And it has a easy to use declarative language for data service creation. So I'll go into these points in a bit more detail. So the data service description language, so it's a basically XML based language where declaratively, we can say, okay, what are the operations that are going to happen in the data service? So, like, we start from, as shown here, we start from defining data sources, and then we say, okay, data service queries. Okay, what are the queries that are going to be interfaced with the data sources, and the operations. So, queries can actually refer to multiple data sources, and operation can refer to a query and resource. So. It has a relationship like that. So as you can see here, query referring to multiple data sources means we can do like data federation and so on. So as I mentioned before, so we have like lots of data connectors, like from starting from RDBMS, spreadsheet connectors for big data, data sources, web scraping and so on. So we have a comprehensive list, and also with this, the data federation features I mentioned earlier, that can be done with the feature called nested queries. So basically, you can mix and match multiple query results into a single result set and have it in a single service operation. And of course, also we can create our own custom data sources. So if you don't have the required connector already listed there, you can create your own one using some Java code. So there are a few ways you can create that in different levels, in different functional levels. So by doing that, you can plug in your own data source as well. And also we have some batch processing capabilities. So we have like both server-side batch processing and client-side batch processing. Server-side means it's like somewhat of a transaction handling scenario. We can, you can define a transaction boundary and say what are the operations that needs to happen in the middle, and we can execute in the server side in a single transaction. So this will all, also support distributed transactions as well. If you use the proper XA drivers, that will support as well. Client-side batch processing is a typical case where from the client, you can send multiple, basically, you can send data from multiple requests basically at once. Like the payload can contain several records of data. So in a single request, you can add, like, for example, in an insert, database insert, you can add multiple data batches. So so for like, if you have like high volume of data to be inserted, this is very useful. And of course, I mentioned earlier, so the REST support, so we natively support that as well, from with both output format as XML and JSON also. And yeah, as I mentioned, so data federation support, so you can, like with a single request, you can get data from multiple target data sources and merge it and return it as a single response. So that is also supported. And so finally, so this is like the like a reference architecture of data integration solutions like we can do. So as you can see, so in the middle we have the business process server where we will define all the workflows that that needs to happen with the data integration scenarios, like the scenarios I mentioned earlier. So this will, so the logic inside that will be interfaced with a system like the data service server, the ESB, and the DAS. So data service server, as I mentioned now, that's purely for using for accessing and manipulating the data. And so if you have any other systems, like not purely databases, like other systems like okay, Salesforce or anything like that, that you want to look up some custom information or anything, you can use the the comprehensive list of connectors that are available through the ESB. So you can do a service call and look it up, and maybe merge it with other data and so on. So that is also available by interfacing with the ESB. And of course, for the profiling and the data quality aspects, for getting the monitoring done, we can interface the workflows with the data analytics server to basically emit events on what are the actions you will be doing inside the workflows, like okay, what are the transformations, the data cleansing, and so on. Those information can be sent there, do some analysis, and probably have some UIs also, because with the dashboard support there. So this this basically contains that simple architecture, so like a reference where you can do the data integration. And so this basically lists down all those actions, as I said, like again, like the human task support for data, the human interaction as well with the BPS and so on. This is basically it.